This video is about showing a singular fundamental concept in calculus, and how rethinking can make an understanding be more intuitive. I take a subjective stance on this matter, because I believe it is how a person imagines ideas within their reality, i.e. set of beliefs or perceptions that will make the process of learning them meaningful, if not truly successful. This video is not about trying to explain calculus by writing it out, but just investigating an aspect that gave rise to it as a particular solution, very conceptually. It will not be going over formulas or step-by-step deductions, so don't worry. This video assumes you've already gone through calculus and have an applicable understanding for it to really work. But this isn't really necessary if you just want to prepare for understanding calculus. This video only tries to have you reassess calculus as how it came to be there in a very general sense. But my intention is to make it more than that. I'm also trying to help showcase a skill in conceptualizing matters so that they can be more easily understood by yourself and others. And as an aside, Einstein did prescribe that you should be able to explain something in such a way that even a child could understand it in order to truly understand that concept yourself. Hopefully, you'll see this as a creative process that you might be able to emulate in the future in order to deepen your understanding for other topics. I want to say that in order to adequately demonstrate any idea, such as the use of calculus, you have to first design a context for this idea to be understood in. By context, I mean a frame of reference where I can easily derive this concept. If I can reframe the problem, then I might be able to better understand the answer. It would also help if we could include the problems that calculus attempts to help solve, yet again, only very abstractly. If we show the origins of calculus, that is, the need for calculus, it itself should be an easier concept to tackle. Let me point out first a set of different things for which this is very similar. That is to say, easily relatable to the way we are seeing things currently. Drawing can be related by its visual component to math's visualization technique found in methods such as graphing. When you're beginning to learn how to draw, the very first thing you learn about are points, lines, and planes. Now, can you tell me what is the difference between these three things? Arguably, the difference between these three things are the number of dimensions they all have. They are simply marks that extend in different directions. I only say arguably because this is a concept I'm going to attack later to help visualize calculus. In order to do that, we have to understand what language is. It is a number of ideas and relationships that help compose more complicated ones. That is, vocabulary and syntax, in which case, for drawing, it would be using dots, lines, and planes. By using these, I can try to visualize and describe everything that I see before me. That, at the very least, is the chief desire for all languages to be able to do. After all, these new things are only more complicated reiterations of the previously given three things. But there are limitations to languages, hence the reason why we have so many different ones in different technical areas, such as computer science. Each one has advantages and disadvantages, and that's the reason why we also need calculus. I can illustrate this by having you describe everything you see in front of you with only the three things that I gave you previously. That is, with points, lines, and planes. So limit yourself to these and take a lot of care. I want you to be able to represent everything you see before you absolutely perfectly. I don't want any sloppy presentations. This is relevant in math because our chief concern are equations. It is only by relating something to something else that we can say we start to truly understand that thing. And that is the problem where calculus comes in well. If all your shapes were exclusively geometric, you'd be fine. But as you can see, we have a lot of curvilinear shapes out there. That is to say, you have straight lines and also have curved ones. What do you do? How do you represent these curves with exclusively the initially given language of a point, line, and plane? It's at this point some people might tell you that we make these things infinitely small so that they can fit in these most granular of places. At the base of a curve where the difference of the angle would be smallest, then progressively larger as you go further out. But that's not a very appealing answer, is it? If you have no questions and feel good, then it is. But if you were really paying attention, you probably would. This is an aside, but a good belief to have. You can make this explanation more functionally and aesthetically appealing than that, I believe. The benefit to reanalyzing this is to understand it in a way that makes it more applicable to other things. How many of us learn something, then forget it because it doesn't seem to relate to anything? By making this a standard practice for yourself, you'll learn how to be a creative. Creatives are seldomly bored, as they can either for fun or utility come up with meaning for other things. I'm going to make it so that your conception of drawing seems to be the same as your conception for calculus. Believe it or not, I don't need to add anything that's not inherently there to my given language of a dot, line, plane to accommodate a curve. Because I have perspective, I can make these things smaller or bigger as much as I want. Just by distancing or approaching myself from the object, it inherently gets smaller or larger. Notice how I haven't changed anything, but just used something that was already inherently there to acquire something I needed. This is one of the reasons why math can be beautiful. When you can show how other things can be reduced to a simpler set of axioms, theorems, or just ideas in general, then there is a sense of unity and order to things, a sense that things are not discrete from one another, just variations of one particular thing. It's an attempt to simplify everything down to a core set of values, just like how biologists do when they enjoy the concept of something such as reductionism. That is, putting biological phenomena into terms of a central set of ideas. For example, that comparatively advantageous genetic traits will become predominant for a population of a species in an environment through a component of evolution, i.e. natural selection. But back to drawing. If I can make a plane out of a dot by magnifying my perspective on the dot itself, this should be conversely true as well. If I get farther out, then that plane will become a dot. But how do you make a line out of the dot? I would have to change it, right? The exact thing we said that we were not going to do. If I did, that would be cheating, right? Sometimes you can answer the problem by questioning the context the problem was developed in. Sometimes by challenging one of the presumptions made holds the answer to the riddle. So I'm going to bring up something about how things exist in real life. When I look at something, most things are seemingly static, right? My concept of an apple, probably one which is not moving, and I'm sure all of you would imagine the same exact thing. Because why would it be, necessarily? But you and I know from basic science class that every molecule within that apple is constantly moving, given their vibrational energies. So what, you might ask? Well, if I was to be perfectly precise with myself on how that apple should be represented, it very well would have to be vibrating a little bit, constantly moving. Because that's the only way how things exist. Nothing is static. The property of being static only comes from my inability to discern movement. That's key here. It's a concept that was born exclusively from your perception and nothing real. It was only by our limitation in perspective allowed this concept to exist. Maybe we should talk about our perspective when it comes to how things exist in general. So now, maybe, I can answer the problem I gave a little bit earlier. In conclusion from earlier, knowing that all things are moving and their existences cannot be discrete/isolated from a frame of reference, That is to say, it has to exist with respect to a time interval. I make this connection between movement and time because you can't have one without the other. Given what we said beforehand, it should be true that a dot is vibrating, and at any one time it should be vibrating in a predominant direction. And as a side note, I do know of a possible counterargument to that, but I think I have a counter to that counter as well. So, if I saw a ball moving back and forth from T0 to T final, but I slowed my brain down to only being able to register movements that would be slower than this, it would look like the dot was occupying the full space between point A and point B, the beginning and end of this horizontal movement constituting a line. Or if I limited my perspective to being able to discern objects exclusively of a larger magnitude, then it would have to be perfectly still with no kinetic energy for me to see it as a dot and not something which is relatively more oblong, essentially. So either changing how I process things spatially or temporally, I will change how each one of these three things behaves, effectively changing their identities. At the very least, if only by a trick of perception. The goal of this video was to think in a way that is not often talked about, but is often emulated in order to solve mathematical problems, that if certain concepts were reassessed, they might show you other things, like how math can relate to drawing, giving more meaning to both of them simultaneously. And by meaning, I mean something that seems to contain personal relevance to you, in the way that it might shed light on reality. Or at least that is how things become personally relevant to me. In this video, we essentially tried to structure a basic set of ideas to form more complicated ones to derive a better resolution of the world we see.